candidate, Elaine Jones.
I could get to Scotland without reference to a controversial magical decision that I took in Wales, but I didn't quite manage that. In fact, in Wales I've had to decide not to wear black and white as a colour in order to avoid attracting comments on that particular policy decision. I'd like to start by thanking you for the tremendous welcome here in Inverness. You've gone out of your way as SNP members to make me and other Plaid members feel included and welcome at your conference. It's a real pleasure to be here at your celebratory conference. After the year you've had, this is the gig everyone wants to attend. In fact, whereas in previous years, Plaid Cymru speakers strikes a bit of a lonely figure in the SNP conference, this year there's a substantial contingent of Plaid members at your conference. You could almost make a rugby team out of us. Excuse me, but it's almost impossible for a Welsh person not to mention rugby these days. And I have to be honest, if Wales had made the Rugby World Cup final this morning, then all of us would have probably stayed at home in Wales for that event, and not even the prospect of an SNP conference could have tempted us away. Honestly, from a politician. As I was starting to consider my words for this conference on Thursday afternoon, I happened to follow a few Twitter comments from your Cabinet Secretary, Richard Lockhead. He was in Luxembourg for Council of Ministers meetings. Up until May of this year, I had been the Welsh Minister attending those meetings alongside Richard. I was struck by Richard's tweet on Thursday from the Council of Ministers where he said, and I won't attempt his accent or his voice, where he said, hopefully in coming years I will be here representing Scotland at the top table, giving farmers and fishermen a loud voice. At those Council of Ministers meetings, I well remember the frustration felt by Richard, an SNP minister, me, a Plaid minister, and a Sinn Féin minister, having to sit quietly behind a UK Secretary of State with no seat and no voice at the main table, and having to fight at times, actually, a turf war with DEFRA civil servants over who got the second row seats at those Council of Ministers meetings. There are many reasons for both Wales and Scotland to become independent states within the European Union, but the fact that the interests of our fishermen and our farmers are articulated by the English Minister at European Council is pretty persuasive for me, especially when that English Minister speaks against the best interests of our fishermen and our farmers. In my mind that the interests of Scottish farmers and fishermen would be better served by Richard Lockhead having a seat around the Council of Ministers table and Scotland being a full member state of the European Union. To this conference, I bring the congratulations from all Plaid Cymru members on your resounding success at last May's Scottish general election. And on behalf of Plaid Cymru, we wish you all the very best as you stride confidently to realise the potential of your people and the establishment of an independent Scottish state. You will have our solidarity and our support, and no doubt a few willing volunteers making the trip up to Scotland to help you with your campaign over the coming weeks. Admit to a bit of jealousy, but your success has been a tremendous inspiration to us in Wales. As you know, we didn't get the result we wanted at our general election. We lost a few of our most able politicians, and we ended up with fewer assembly seats. But this year has not all been doom and gloom for us in Wales. In March, the people of Wales overwhelmingly voted yes in a referendum that has led to the establishment of the first Welsh legislature that, with proper lawmaking powers in almost 600 years. All but one of the Welsh counties voted yes in that referendum, a sure indicator that despite the best efforts of our unionist opponents to divide our people, In March, the people of Weir spoke with one voice and declared that the days of begging Westminster for legislative power were over in Wales. Plaid Cymru is now undertaking a root and branch review of our party. It's an exciting new chapter for us. By March of next year, we will have a new leader as Ieuan Wyn-Jones steps down with a proud legacy of leading Plaid Cymru into Welsh Government for the first time in 2007 and ensuring the establishment of a law-making Welsh Parliament. As our party, in our conference this year, a few weeks ago, we committed our party to state clearly our aim for Welsh independence within the European Union. It may seem strange to you that we hadn't done this previously, as specifically as that our aspiration was for an independent state in our constitution. It seemed a bit strange to me also, I'll admit it. We are confident that Welsh interests in the 21st century would be better served by independence, better served than dependence on a British state that continues to ignore our interests. Welsh interests are also served by a strong Plaid Cymru. And as elected members and party members, we are committed to reinvigorating Plaid Cymru for the sake of Wales. Often following election setbacks, political parties can fall apart and enter a period of internal turmoil. It's happened to us in the past. But this time, there's been no infighting or bitching. We are resolutely determined to build our party and continue to build our country. I'm more motivated than ever, more ambitious than ever, and more frustrated than ever at the opportunities that are lost to us in not being a self-governing nation. It is rather appropriate to be discussing the UK government's approach to the right of Celtic nations for self-determination here in Inverness. Events that took place in this city have had far-reaching consequences in this regard. It was a Welshman, David Lloyd George, who convened the first ever UK cabinet meeting outside London in Inverness on the 7th of September 1921, almost exactly 90 years ago. From that meeting came the so-called Inverness Formula, the formula that laid the basis for the birth of the Irish Free State. A Welshman hosting a UK cabinet meeting in a Scottish city to address the constitutional future of Ireland. It sounds a bit like the start of a politically incorrect joke, but as we know, the results changed UK politics forever. From that historic cabinet meeting came the realisation that Westminster could no longer deny a people their right to self-government. 90 years ago, David Lloyd George, a Welsh politician, a one-time supporter of Welsh Home Rule, worked to deliver Home Rule for another nation, not his own. How many British Unionist politicians have we seen over the years who support campaigns to free people all over the world, but choose to deny and ridicule the attempt of their own? Another one of those kind of politicians in Wales these days. His name is Peter Hain, LP. Although, unlike David Lloyd George, people will not, I doubt, bother to remember Peter Hain in 90 years' time. Peter Hain tried every which way he could as Secretary of State for Wales to delay this year's law-making referendum in Wales. Peter Hain's a self-proclaimed lifetime supporter of proportional representation, but now he wants to change the Welsh Assembly electoral system and remove proportional representation so that Labour can have a better chance of becoming a majority government. British Unionist politicians who time and time again put the interests of their party or their personal ambition before the interests of their people and their nation. And in Scotland face the real possibility of creating an independent Scotland. We in Wales are left to consider what would be left. A UK government governing on all English matters, on only some Welsh matters and even fewer Northern Irish matters. It is now time for the rest of us to have the debate on the future constitutional relationship of the countries of the British Islands. It is time to debate equality, not subservience and dependence. To us, the United Kingdom is currently a pretense of a country. After a yes vote in your referendum, it could no longer pretend to anyone, not even itself. Your debate in Scotland on the future of your country must inspire us to debate the future of our nation. What happens to Scotland matters to us. As Scotland strides forward with confidence, Plaid Cymru will not allow Wales to be left behind as a constitutional afterthought. In Wales, we cannot rely on a sluggish, unambitious, reactive Labour Welsh government to make the case for the Welsh nation. Once again, Wales will need Plaid Cymru to lead the debate and make change happen. Friends, our two ancient nations have shared a past, and I know we have a shared future. I know that what makes our civic nationalism resilient and righteous, in contrast to British unionism, is that our civic nationalism is built on the principle that our respective nations are no better than any other, but we are just as deserving and just as good. Our nations have embarked on exciting paths, Wales and Scotland on two different paths that lead, I hope, to the same destination. We all know that constitutional and fiscal independence alone will not solve all the challenges that face us, but that independence will give our people the tools to finally release and realise our enormous potential. I wish you well, Conference, at this historic point as your nation prepares to take a place among the free nations of the world. But I ask one thing of you. Keep a safe seat warm for Wales. We'll be right behind you.